Hello guys, welcome to our study circle. This is Jain. I am going to start a brand new course on Tamil Nadu history class 11. This video might be lengthy because I am going to explain each and every meaning also. It is especially for the beginners. Without making delay, we will get into the topic. And the chapter name is in India geographical features and their impact on history. Geographical features of India. Geographical factors influenced the history of India. The Indian subcontinent is a well-defined geographical unit. India majorly divided into three regions. First one, in the diagram you can see northern part, mostly northern part consists of Himalayas, and in the middle part Indo-Gangetic plains, and the southern part we can see southern peninsula. Why we call as peninsula? Because India is surrounded by three sides of water. Eastern side is Bay of Bengal, western side is Arabian Sea, bottom side is Indian Ocean. If it would have covered by four sides of water, then we would have been called it as island. So India is not island, don't get confused. So there are five countries in the subcontinent. First is India, Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan and Bangladesh. You can see in the picture. Please go through it. Why India called as subcontinent? We will deal about that in further lectures. And now we are going to discuss about the Himalayan mountains. The Himalayan mountains are situated on the north of India. We know that Himalayan mountains are constitute northernmost part of India. Constituting northernmost part of India. It starts from Pamir region in the extreme northwest. That mighty Himalayas range extends toward the northeast. So this Himalayas start from Pamir Mountains in the extreme northwest, and it will extend toward the east side. So it has a length of nearly 2560 kilometers. What length will be 2560 meters, and average breadth is 240 to 320 kilometers. Just go through it, and no exams there will be, like they don't ask like this. The highest peak of the Himalayas is known as Mount Everest. You may have heard, I hope you will know about that. The highest peak in the Himalayas is Mount Everest, which height being 8869 meters. You know one thing, Himalayas often called as rising mountains. Why day by day it's rising? Because I hope you people know about the plate tectons and moments due to that plates collision. It is day by day increasing. You will be know more about that in geographical lectures, which we will go which we will start in further times. And Himalayas act as natural wall and protects the country against the cold Arctic winds blowing from the Siberian through Central Asia. So Siberia generally is a country in Russia. So from there the cold winds come from Central Asia. So this Himalayas will stand as a natural barrier, and it protects us from that winds. And this keeps climate northern India fairly warm throughout the year, as we see point above. So Himalayan region is mostly inhospitable. Inhospitable means we cannot live there in winter and generally covered with snow. Himalayas stood as a natural barrier to protect Indian against invasions. How these Himalayas protected India against invasions? What is invasion? Invasion is basically other country king or other king come to India and he defeat the Indian rulers. He will take some wealth and he will make some treaties with Indian rulers, and he goes back to his country. So how this how like this how used to be happen. So what happened? This Himalayas protected. How this Himalayas protected when suppose one king is coming from Central Asia, when this king come near to the Himalayan mountains, he used like he sees it like that lofty mountains and all. We cannot climb it, right? So he generally goes back to his country. This how that was to be happen. And but the passes in the northwest, in the north, it starts from Pamir and it extends towards east, right? So northeast there was some passes like such as Khyber, Bolan, Kurram, and Gomal provided the east routes between the India and Central Asia. So these were the some passes like Khyber, Bolan, Kurram, and Gomal provided the routes between India and Central Asia. From east side there was a mountains, right? So there were no passes. So these passes are situated in Hindu Kush mountain, Sulaiman and Khetar ranges. From prehistoric times, prehistoric time means before the history was not written. So there was a continuous flow of traffic through these passes. Which passes? These passes. Above we have discussed na Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. So many people come to India through these passes as invaders and immigrants. The Indo-Aryans, the Indo-Greeks, Parthians, Sakyas, Kushanas, Huns, and Turkish enter India through these passes. So one of the important valleys, see here, the Swat Valley in the region formed another important route. We must have heard that Alexander of Macedon came to India through this route. Sorry for the spelling, India. So he came from the Swat Valley. We will discuss this about in further lectures, like Battle of Hyderabad, and he will fight with the great Indian ruler called as Porus. He is the one ruler. He stands against the Alexander. Then many Indian rulers are afraid of him, but this Porus didn't afraid like them like all. So it will be interesting in further lectures. We'll see it in further lectures. The Indigo Gangetic Plain is irrigated by three important rivers: the Ganga, Ganges, Indus, and Brahmaputra. So we can call this as also perennial rivers. Perennial river means which has water throughout the years. And peninsular rivers, they drain easily. They drain like seasonal river. We can call those also seasonal rivers also. So this vast plain is most fertile and productive because of the alluvial soil brought by these streams of rivers and its tributaries. So what happens when river is flowing? With that water, some what sediments also come and deposited in some plains. It become very fertile. It is it will be productive for agriculture. We can see that in further. The Indus River rises beyond the Himalayas, and its major tributaries are the Jhelum, Chenab, Ravi, Sutlej, and Bias. So basically, this Indus River originates in Mansovar Lake in Tibet, and it enters into the India through the Ladakh districts. Its main tributaries are the Jhelum, Chenab, Ravi, Bias, Sutlej. These are the important rivers of that Indus. And the Punjab plains are benefited by the Indus River system. The literal meaning of the term Punjab is the land of five rivers. Sindh is situated at the lower valley of the Indus. So in Punjab, these five rivers, the Jhelum, Chenab, Ravi, Satluj, Bias, will go through from Punjab. So that's why it is more fertile. The land of five rivers referring the I have explained this already. The Indus Plain is known for its fertile soil. And the Indigo Gangetic Plains contributed to the rise of urban centers, particularly on the river banks or at the confluence of river. The urban culture flourished in this valley. So in this area, urbanization started. Many cities are grown up, grew up, and the Harappan civilization also originated in this place only. I think, I hope you people know about the Harappan civilization. Even you don't know, we will discuss about that in next lecture. And the Vedic culture prospered in this the western Gangetic plain. Banaras, Allahabad, Agra, Delhi, and the Pataliputra are the some of the important cities of the Gangetic plain. So after the Harappan civilization, the Vedic culture also prospered in that Indo-Gangetic plains only. He gave some of the important cities in that plains, such as Allahabad, Delhi, and Pataliputra. So the city of Pataliputra was situated at the confluence of Sun River with the Gangas. So why city of Pataliputra is important? Because it acted political center of many kingdoms, like such as Mauryas, Sangas, Guptas, and other kingdoms. Now Southern Peninsula. Till now we have discussed about Himalayan mountains and Indo-Gangetic plains. We are going to discuss about Southern Peninsula. Southern Peninsula means, already I have explained what is peninsula, and the Vindhya and Satpura mountains along with Narmada and the Tapi rivers from the great dividing line between northern and southern India. So this Vindhya, Satpura mountains with this Narmada and Tapi, these all places this will be the line which divides the southern and eastern India. Okay, southern and northern India. The plateau to the south of the Vindhya mountains is known as Deccan Plateau. It consists of volcanic rocks, which is different from the northern mountains. Here we can see black soil. Okay, these rocks are easier to cut into. We find a number of rock cut monasteries and temples in the Deccan. The Deccan Plateau is flanked by the eastern and western Ghats. Here we can see, we have another. Just pause this video and go through the names: Malabar, Konkan, Coromandel, on North Africa, Utkal Plain, and Cape of Comore. Just go through those names. It will be helpful. And the Coromandel Coast stands between the Eastern Ghats and the Bay of Bengal. You can see the Coromandel Coast in the picture. I have said now that picture only. Just pause the video and see the this Coromandel Coast that stands between the Eastern Ghats and the Bay of Bengal. The Western Ghats run along the Arabian Sea, and the land between these are known as Konkan up to Goa. Behind the Kanara, the southern part is known as Malabar. So in the left side, Kanara, Malabar, Konkan, we can see. Right side, Northern Ficus and Coromandel Coast. The passes in Western Ghats like Junnar, Kanheri, and Karle linked the trade routes between the Western ports. In the southern end remains the famous Palghat Pass. This is very important in the perspective. Is the pass across the Ghats from the Kaveri Valley to the Malabar Coast. The Palghat Pass was an important trade route for the Indo-Roman trade in the ancient time. In the ancient time, this Palghat Pass was the important trade route between those which countries? India and the Roman Empire. Okay, the Anai Modi is the highest peak in the Southern Peninsula. We have discussed that highest peak in Himalayas is answer in the comment section. In the Southern Peninsula, highest peak is Anai Modi, which is present in Tamil Nadu. Okay, Doddapeta is the another highest peak in the Western Ghats. In southern peninsula Anaimodi in Western Ghats Dodapeda. These are also important. And the Eastern Ghats are not very high and have several openings caused by the eastern flow of the rivers into the Bay of Bengal. So Western Ghats, Eastern Ghats is there, right? Eastern Ghats have not that much height. Comparatively, Western Ghats have high hills and high slope, and the Eastern Ghats have not that much. Like, generally, simply remember that Eastern Ghats, Western Ghats is high and Eastern Ghats is slow. Okay, so it has some openings. The eastward flow of rivers into Bay. Just only Narmada and Tapi flows to left. Remaining like Ganga, Krishna, these all rivers drain into this Bay of Bengal only, right? That only is saying. The port cities of Raikamedu and Mamallapuram, Kaveri Patnam were situated on the Coromandel coast. We have seen in the map the Coromandel. If you are not seen, just go through it. India, a land of diversity. India proved to be a melting point of numerous races. The pre-Aryans, the Indo-Aryans, the Greeks, the Santians, the Huns, the Turkish, and etc. made India their home. Like, India has a diversity, like different cultures, different types of people, like Indo-Aryans, pre-Aryans, Indo-Aryans, Greeks, Huns. These people cannot. So, these people made their home. India is a diversified country. Okay. So, since ancient time, India has been the land of several religions. India is witnessed in the ancient India that birth of Hinduism, Jainism, which we'll see in the next chapters, upcoming chapters. In Jainism, Jainism will be most interesting chapter. We'll learn about the Tirthankaras and all, okay? And Buddhism also. So you may have familiar with Buddhism. And the name of Bharata Varsha, or the land of Bharata, was given to the whole country after the name of ancient tribe called Bharata. Sometimes we call India as Bharat also. From this tribe we got Bharat name to India. Okay, people living on the Sindhu or in the Indus, and so they named the whole country after this river. The word Hind is derived from the Sanskrit term Sindhu, and in course of time the country came to be known as India. In the Greek Hind, sometimes we call Hindustan, right? From this only the Hindustan came. Okay, we are up with the lesson, and we'll meet in next lecture. And I'm going to finish this book in 20 or 25 days. Then you will be fluent. Then you will be answer the all the questions regarding to ancient and medieval India. And after that, we will move into modern India also. Spectrum book. I will deal with that also. After this, I hope you people all like this. Sorry for my English. I have made some grammatical mistakes as well. Okay, guys. We'll meet in next video. Bye bye. Have a nice day.